Hi, I'm Ted Balick with Reason.tv. By now you've probably seen Slumdog Millionaire, the film with a rags-to-riches tale, some brotherly betrayal, and a love story.
Perhaps the only people who don't love the film are those who compete against it at awards shows.
And the Golden Globe goes to...
A.R. Rahman, Slumdog Millionaire.
Slumdog Millionaire.
Slumdog Millionaire.
The film follows an Indian orphan named Jamal, who grows up and hits it big on the famous game show Who Wants to Be a Millionaire.
Ladies and gentlemen, what a player!
It's an extremely popular show in India. Everybody watches it.
Shikha Dalmia is a senior analyst at Reason Foundation and a native of India.
It's a perfect, you know, metaphor for the mood of the country, which is that, the country is experiencing this economic boom and people are, impatient to get rich.
In some ways, the script tells the story of India itself, a poverty-stricken underdog with its own rags-to-riches tale, or at least something like it.
Slumdog Millionaire is a very interesting movie because it's come at a time when India is taking off. So poverty rate in the last 15 years has been cut in half.
Roughly 300 million people, equivalent to the population of the entire United States, pulled out of poverty.
This is like real poverty. Very high infant mortality rates of people not knowing where their next meal is going to come from.
So how did conditions improve so quickly for so many? After all, India has been stuck in poverty for a long time. Even breaking from British rule in 1947 failed to turn things around.
The prevailing thinking was that the British had been looting the country, and there is a grain of truth in that. The problem was that the Indian leaders, the political leaders at that time, had this very Fabian socialist idea. And the problem with that was that it completely thwarted the entrepreneurship in the country.
Dalmia says crushing regulations stalled progress. For example, what if the CEO of an IT company wanted to do something simple like attend a conference in the United States?
It would take him close to 6 months to a year to get permission to attend one conference. If he wanted to import computers into the country, he would need a separate permission for that.
The stifling bureaucracy was even worse for India's poor. Just getting permission to sell food from a small cart meant having to get all kinds of licenses.
So most of them don't get the licenses that they want, which means that they become targets for constant official harassment, police harassment.
For so long, poverty has been the dominant image of India. But then, in the 1990s, Americans began to see India as something else, as an emerging high-tech powerhouse. Something changed. What was it?
So in the 1990s, India started its economic liberalization effort, and it did three things. It started cutting taxes. They started trade liberalization. If an IT company wanted to import a computer, it no longer had to get permission from a bureaucrat. So they liberalized trade policy and they deregulated the industry.
Jamal Malik, you're absolutely right!
Not even the beloved game show created as much wealth as expanding trade, cutting taxes, and deregulating business.
And all of those three things made it just easier for businesses to establish themselves and provide jobs for millions of other Indians and essentially cut the poverty rate in half.
Millionaires were made, but more importantly, the reforms boosted the lot of those at the bottom.
For one IT company, it doesn't just employ computer professionals. It also needs landscaping services. It needs cleaning services. It needs restaurants. And so there have been just tremendous spillover effects that have essentially produced a huge support service sector and allowed people to lift themselves out of poverty.
We are going to have to greatly strengthen our regulatory apparatus.
Yet here in America, we're turning away from market reform.
I chunked aside some of my free market principles.
Contrary to popular belief, George W. Bush had chucked his free market principles long before the recent bailouts. In 2007 alone, he stuffed the federal government with more than 78,000 pages worth of new regulations.
It's just this great conundrum at that same time that deregulation and markets have produced such dramatic results in India that they are falling into suspicion in America and the West, because in India, after five decades of government failure, we had a small dose of markets which has produced this dramatic results.
So many Indians remain poor, says Dalmia, because market reforms didn't go far enough. Politicians cut red tape for high-tech entrepreneurs, but not for their low-tech counterparts.
So, you know, you walk on the streets of India, and it's not uncommon to see, you know, scenes of policemen demanding a permission slip from a roadside vendor, and when this guy can't produce it, just shooing him away or evicting his wares, or if he has made some money that, you know, that day, he might bribe the policeman to get him off his back. And Slumdog Millionaire actually did a very good job of catching the plight of those people.
The entrepreneurial orphans often join gangs, says Dalmia, because it's so hard to run a legitimate business.
I'll go for D, London.
Since few will hit it rich on a game show, millions of Indians need some other way to escape poverty and crime.
What India needs to do is continue apace with its liberalization, but just expand it to include the poor people and the people who are powerless, release them from the shackles of government corruption and government bureaucracy.
Expanding India's reforms may not result in millions of millionaires, but it may produce more thousandaires, more people with full stomachs living long lives. For Reason.tv, I'm Ted Ballinger.